Hello students, now we'll be solving memory-based questions of K20. For more video solutions on K20, subscribe to our channel and don't forget to click the bell icon for instant notification.
Hello students, welcome to the Gate Academy. We are proud to announce that we are the first one to provide video solutions to the instrumentation paper of K20 2020 which happened today. So in this particular session, we are going to look at detailed solutions of control systems subject. So in control systems, in today's paper especially, we got two questions from time response analysis. One you can say that pertains to steady state analysis and the other belongs to transient response analysis. And also there are questions based on frequency response analysis, one on steady state frequency response analysis and the other on the steady state stability parameters, like you can say gain margin and phase margin, right? So one is on that, and we have one question from compensators, we have one more question from root locus also. So let us look at the detailed solutions of each and every question as we have seen here, right? Along with marks, we'll discuss various aspects related to the paper, control systems paper of instrumentation today. So the first question which you can look at the board is something like this, right? So a particular system is given and a particular unity feedback system is given and the value of K is asked because its response is also given when the input x of t is equal to 10 times of u of t is applied, right? When the input x of t is equal to 10 times of u of t is applied, the response of this particular system is given and you have to find out the value of K. K is equal to, right? So you should find out the value of K. So in order to just obtain the solution for this particular particular question, we can have various aspects, various methods. So let us look at one by one method and let us figure out which is the best method, right? So the first method, you can go like this. What is the overall transfer function of this particular system? See, this particular system is given, x of t is provided as input to that and y of t is your output, right? So if x of s is the frequency domain input, y of s will be the frequency domain output, right? So the steady state value of the output y of t, you can clearly observe from this particular figure, right? The steady state value of output is 8, whereas the steady state value of input, you already know, 10 times of u of t, it is 10, right? Therefore, you obtain the overall transfer function of this and you obtain y of s and apply final value theorem on that. So what is the overall transfer function of this particular system? It is g of s by 1 plus g of s, because h of s is simply 1. Therefore, overall transfer function is equal to k by 1 plus st divided by 1 plus k by 1 plus st. If you simplify that, you will simply get k divided by 1 plus st plus k. So this is your transfer function, overall transfer function. To this particular system, whose transfer function is k by 1 plus st plus k, an input is provided. What is the input? The input is 10 times of u of t, right? So if 10 times of u of t is provided as an input to this particular system, what is the steady state value of output? Steady state value of output y of t, you can already see from the figure, right? Therefore, if this is the time domain input, what is its frequency domain value? Frequency, in frequency domain, you can write x of s as 10 divided by s, simply the Laplace transformation of x of s. Therefore, what is the output y of s? Y of s, you can write y of s is equal to x of s multiplied by the transfer function. You can see x of s. X of s is equal to 10 by s, 10 by s multiplied by the transfer function k by 1 plus st plus k. Therefore, it is 10 by s multiplied by k by 1 plus st plus k. This is y of s. So y of s is equal to 10 by s multiplied by k by 1 plus st plus k. Therefore, you have been given the steady state value of output y of t from the graph. Right? From the graph, you can conclude the steady state value of output is 8. Therefore, limit s tends to 0, limit t tends to infinity y of t is equal to limit s tends to 0 s into y of s. And what is the value of y of s? 10 by s multiplied by k by 1 plus st plus k. Therefore, this is equal to limit s tends to 0 s into 10 by s k by 1 plus st plus k. So this s cancels and you're left with, if you put s is equal to 0 in this, you'll be left with 10 k by 1 plus 0 plus k. And the value of this, the steady state value of the output is given from the graph, that is equal to 8 simply. Therefore, this entire thing is equal to 8. Therefore, 10 k is equal to 8 plus 8k. I'm just cross multiplying this. 8 plus 8k. Therefore, k will be is equal to 4. Therefore, the answer for this question is k is equal to 4. If you look at some previous papers, right? So you can easily say the same question is given in Instrumentation 2008. Same question, except a little change here. The input here is 10 times of u of t, whereas the input given in that particular question is simply u of t, unit step, right? Everything else is same. So k's value going to be different? No, the same value. So students who have practiced previous Instrumentation gate 2008 question, or else all the previous gate questions, right, there's a chance that they have this value of k indirectly stored in their memory, and immediately after looking into the question, they'll just mark the answer, right? K is equal to 4. So the same question you can also see in Instrumentation. Not exactly same, but except this, everything is same. Except this 10, everything is same. It is Instrumentation 2008 question, same to same, right? So this is one approach, and I do not say this is the smartest approach. See, this is a blind man approach. So if at all you cannot think, you'll directly do this, right? You have minimal amount of thinking, then you'll apply this, right? So there are several other methods. The second method which you can apply here is, see, the input is 10 and the output is 8. The difference between input and output, the difference between C, y of t and x of t is how much? 10 minus 8, that is equal to 2. What is this 2? This is nothing but steady state error. You can see here, see, this is x of s, this is y of s, and x of s minus y of s is nothing but e of s. X of s minus y of s is simply e of s, steady state error, right? So steady state error is 2, you can say. This is ESS, right? This is the steady state error. So simply, if you apply the formula for steady state error, right? So if at all you remember the formula for steady state error, also you can calculate, even if you do not remember the formula, it is okay, you can calculate, right? So if at all you remember the formula for steady state error for this kind of system, for your for step inputs, ESS is equal to A divided by 1 plus KP. What is KP? KP is limit S tends to 0, G of S, H of S. Here H of S is 1. KP is called as positional error constant. Positional error constant. So A is the magnitude of the step input applied. What is the magnitude of the step input applied? It is simply 10. So put A is equal to 10. Therefore, ESS is equal to 10 divided by 1 plus KP. KP is limit S tends to 0 G of S. Put S is equal to 0 in this. K divided by 0 plus 1, simply K, right? 10 divided by 1 plus K. And its value is exactly is equal to how much? This is equal to 2. Therefore, 10 is equal to 2 plus 2k. That implies k is equal to 8 divided by 2, that is 4. The value of k is again 4. So you can either use this approach. This is the second approach. You can use this approach also. And there is one more approach. See, you have given a DC input, DC input whose magnitude is 10 unit step input of magnitude 10, which means a DC input, right? So you have given a DC input and you have got a DC output, of course with some transient. Who cares about the transient? We are concerned about the steady state response here. So the steady state output is 8. So what is the gain of this particular system for a DC input, right? That simply is nothing but DC gain, right? So for DC inputs, what is the frequency? For DC, if it is a DC input, frequency f is equal to, frequency is equal to 0, right? If frequency is 0, you can straight away put s is equal to 0. What is s? S is nothing but Dapper's frequency, right? So you can simply substitute s is equal to 0 in what? In the overall transfer function. You know this overall transfer function? Overall transfer function is k by 1 plus st plus k, right? Therefore, simply put s is equal to 0 in this overall transfer function, you will get the DC gain of the system. DC gain of the system is also evident from the input-output relation. What is the relation? Input is 10, output is 8. Output divided by input, 0.8. Therefore, simply put k is equal to 0 in this. Sorry, s is equal to 0 in this. Therefore, the DC gain is k by 1 plus k, that is equal to 0.8. And see, apply a little amplitude. If you can write 0.8 as 4 by 5, right? You can straight away see that k is equal to 4. 4 by 1 plus 4, that is 4 by 5. Therefore, k is equal to 4. So you can calculate the answer verbally, right? So simply without taking pen and paper into your hand, you can simply calculate the answer, right? Such an easy question. In fact, all the questions in today's paper, instrumentation's paper, which happened today, are easier, right? Hope all the other gate subjects, all the other streams gate 2020 papers, I feel they are also going to be easier. So this is a question whose pattern is repeated from 2008. There is one more question which is exactly repeated, and we'll look at that question too. So the answer for this particular question is k is equal to 4. Let us look at the next one. So the second question, which also belongs to the time response analysis, but the time response analysis of a second order system, is like this. You can also look at the link in the check out the link in the description box, which contains a PDF of all these questions along with the answer keys. For solutions, you have to go through the video. So the question is like this. A second order system has poles at minus 3 plus 4j. The system will reach the maximum output for a step input at dash seconds. So for this particular question, see, the thing you have to understand is maximum output for a step input. Maximum output for a step input at what particular time instant? That is asked. The rows, the poles of your first second order system is given. So let us look at the general underdamped response of a second order system. This is an underdamped system. You can clearly see that because the poles are complex conjugates, so it is an underdamped system, and its response is going to be somewhat in this manner. This is its response y of t, or else you can say c of t with respect to time, and the input applied is step input, that is 1, let us say, and the response is going to be somewhat like this. So the instant at which the output reaches its maximum value, that is nothing but peak time, the instant at which maximum peak overshoot occurs. Maximum peak overshoot occurs here, right? You can clearly see. And the time instant at which maximum peak overshoot occurs is TP. And TP is directly given by, TP is equal to pi by omega d seconds. This is TP. So what generally students will do is they'll find out the transfer function. Once the poles of a second order transfer function are given, you can simply find out the transfer function, or else you can find out the characteristic equation. What is the characteristic equation? You can write the characteristic equation in this manner: s minus p1 into s minus p2, right? That is equal to s minus minus 3 plus j4. So it is s plus 3
minus 4j multiplied by s plus 3 plus 4j. So if you multiply them, you can write it as a plus b into a minus b, a square minus b square. Therefore, a square s plus 3 whole square minus 4j square, that is equal to plus 4 square. So this can be written as s square plus 6s, s square plus 6s plus 9 plus 16, that is 25. So this is the characteristic equation. Just compare this characteristic equation with the standard characteristic equation which you have, right? The standard characteristic equation is, you can write it this way, that is s square plus 2 zeta omega n into s plus omega n square. Upon comparison, you can straight away say that the value of omega n square is 25, therefore omega n is simply 5. Omega n is equal to 5. And 2 zeta omega n is equal to how much? That is equal to 6. Therefore, that is equal to 2 zeta will take, and omega n is 5. 2 into 5 into omega n is equal to 6. Therefore, omega n is equal to simply, omega n is equal to 0.6. Omega n is 0.6. So you have to calculate omega d from this. Omega d is simply, omega d is equal to omega n under root 1 minus zeta square. Zeta is cos theta, and under root 1 minus zeta square is sine theta, right? So cos theta is 0.6, sine theta is 0.8. Instrumentation and electrical students, they often deal with this value. Cos theta, if cos theta is 0.6, especially electrical students, if cos theta is 0.6, sine theta is 0.8. So they deliberately give values like this, so that you need not calculate always and always. They don't want a calculator, they want an engineer, right? So omega d is equal to omega n. What is omega n? This is zeta. This is also zeta. What is the value of omega n? Omega n is 25. Therefore, this multiplied by, omega n is 5. 5 multiplied by under root 1 minus 0.6 square. That is 5 multiplied by 0.8. is equal to 4. Therefore, once you got the value of omega d, omega d is equal to 4 radian per second, and the peak time TP, for getting peak time, you just put the value of omega d in this formula. Therefore, that is equal to TP is equal to pi divided by 4 seconds. So the value of pi divided by 4 seconds is 0.7854. The value is 0.7854 seconds. So the answer for your question is 0.7854, right? So this is the approach, and this is the longest approach, and smart students will not go by this approach. So those students who are keen in the class, or else who have a sufficient insight, or those students who have a good practice of this particular subject, right? By looking at the poles, they will simply recognize that the value of omega d is 4, and straight away then write TP is pi by 4 and calculate 0.7854. See, this value is simply omega d, and I'll tell you how, right? So while going through the poles you plot of your second order system, let us say these are the poles and zeros, right? So the imaginary value of your plot corresponds the value of frequency with which the response oscillates. This particular response, it has some oscillatory nature, right? So it oscillates at a frequency of omega d. This is simply omega d. This length is omega n. This length is zeta omega n. These are the aspects you will always remember, right? No need to memorize, you will automatically remember if you have sufficient practice. So this is the characteristic equation. For the standard characteristic equation, you will also have an idea that roots of this characteristic equation are given by s is equal to minus zeta omega n plus or minus j omega d. What is omega d? Omega d is simply omega n under root 1 minus zeta square, right? So just compare, roots of this characteristic equation are simply minus zeta omega n plus or minus j omega d. So straight away you'll get the value of omega d as 4, and TP you can calculate as pi divided by 4, that is 0.7856 seconds. The answer is here, right? So this one also you can just answer verbally without any other procedure, without going deep into it, right? So just if you know this particular formula, that is TP is equal to pi upon omega d seconds. This you have to remember. So that's only this question. Let us look at the other questions also. So let us look at the next question, which is based on root locus. And before continuing to the question, I would like to emphasize on one particular point. It is very, very important for the ECE as well as electrical students to go through these questions, because in many instances we have observed that immediately after a particular stream's exam is over, question is picked up from the same stream and had been asked in the exam of the other stream, right? So it is advisable to go through. Otherwise, at least the models are going to repeat. If not the exact numerical values, at least the models are going to repeat, right? So the question on root locus is like this. The value of k at the breakaway point for a system having open loop transfer function, k divided by s into s plus 2 into s plus 6 is. And this is also an NET type question, that is numerical answer type. So let us look at the detailed solution. So simply you can write the value of k from the characteristic equation. What is the characteristic equation? It is simply 1 plus OLTF, that is nothing but 1 plus g of s h of s is equal to 0. Therefore, the characteristic equation is 1 plus g of s h of s is equal to 0. That is 1 plus k by s into s plus 2 into s plus 6. Right? So this is equal to 0. What you have to obtain is, you have to obtain k in terms of s and differentiate k with respect to s so that you can get the breakaway point. And also you can use one more method. If you just consider this as numerator upon denominator, then n dash of s into d of s minus d dash of s into n of s, if you equate that to 0, you're going to get the breakaway point. If you equate that to 0 and solve for the values of s, you're going to get the breakaway point. Right, so the theory is not required here. So let us look at this. K is equal to simply minus of s into s plus 2 into s plus 6. So I'm just keeping this in a box for our reference. You will come to know why I'm keeping it in the box, right? So dk by ds, let us just expand the value of k first. K is equal to, k can be expanded and can be written like this, negative of s cube plus 8 s square plus 12 s. This is k. Therefore dk by ds, if you differentiate this, dk by ds is equal to 3. Anyways, we are making it to 0. We are equating it to 0. Therefore, I am not considering the negative sign. So it is 3s square plus 16s plus 12 is equal to 0. You have to solve this second order characteristic equation. Sorry, not characteristic equation. You have to solve this second order equation. If you solve this for the values of s, you will get the values of breakpoints. So I have solved it, and the values of s are like this. You know already the procedure how to solve. Right, you can say s is equal to minus b plus or minus root over b square minus 4ac by 2a. B square minus 4ac by 2a. B is 16 and c is 12 and a is 3. Simply, you will get these values. S is equal to minus 4.4305 and s is also is equal to minus 0.9028, right? I can approximately write this as s is equal to minus 0.903, right? I can approximate in that manner. So if you look at them, which breakpoint is valid and which is not valid? So let us look at the region of root locus. So if at all you try to plot the root locus for this system, right, one pole is at origin, the other pole is at minus 2, and the other pole is at minus 6. Therefore, this is the first critical frequency or first singular frequency, and to the left of the first singular frequency, because it is odd number, right? So root locus is going to exist. The second one, this is even, second critical frequency or second singular frequency, this is even, whereas to the left of this is also second, this is third, this is odd. Therefore, here also you are going to have root locus. So where does this point fall? This point falls between 0 and minus 2, right? Therefore, one breakpoint falls between 0 and minus 2, that is at minus 0.903. And the other falls between minus 2 and minus 6, that is minus 4.4305. So which is the valid breakpoint? The valid breakpoint is S is equal to minus 0.903, right? This is valid and this is invalid, right? So if this is invalid, what is the reason? Why is the reason we are getting this, right? This will be valid for inverse root locus. This particular point, this will be valid for inverse root locus, not for root locus. This for root locus, this for inverse root locus, because inverse root locus exists to the left of even numbered critical frequency, that is inverse root locus exists in this particular region. Therefore, this point falls in the region of inverse root locus. This is valid for inverse root locus but not for root locus. So in order to find out the value of K, simply put this value of S in this. Substitute the value of S in this. Therefore, you will directly get the value of K. Therefore, S is equal to minus 0.903. K is equal to minus of minus 0.903 multiplied by 2 minus 0.903 and 6 minus 0.903. therefore, K, if you calculate, if at all you multiply all the three numbers, you will get K is equal to 5.05. You can approximately say the value is 5.05, right? So this is how you can find out the value of K. And you have one more concept. If at all you attend the classes, you would come to know that the product of vector lengths because of poles upon the product of vector lengths because of zeros. This will give you the value of K. So how is this obtained? This is obtained from magnitude condition. K multiplied by the product of vector lengths of zeros upon product of vector lengths of poles. The modulus of this is going to give a value of 1 if the point is a point on root locus, right? So from magnitude condition, we get one more result. That is, you obtain vectors from each and every pole and each and every zero. So this is one pole, from this you obtain a vector, and this is another pole, you obtain a vector. This is one more pole, you obtain a vector from this pole also, this pole to this particular point, right? The product of vector lengths of all these three will give you the value of K. So how will you find out the length? See, this is origin, this is zero, and here to here the distance is 0.903. therefore, K you can write as product of vector lengths of poles to the breakaway point. Right. Therefore, this is not only valid for breakaway point, this is valid for all the points on root locus. Right. So K is equal to product of vector lengths. So this length is how much? 0.903. You want this particular length. From here to here the length is 2, and from here to here the length is 2 minus 0.903. If you can observe, you are getting the same result both ways, right? From here to here the length is 6. Therefore, The effective length from this point to this point is how much? 6 minus this length. This length is 0.903. 6 minus 0.903. Therefore, this is 6 minus 0.903. Therefore, if you calculate, you will get the same value of k. K is equal to 5.049. This is the value of k. Therefore, the answer for this question is 5.049. This is the answer for this particular question. So there are numerous possibilities. There are a number of possibilities in which you can solve the question. So the student who figures out the shortest possibility, that is the possibility which consumes least time to you, is going to succeed with a greater score. That's all. So let us look at the next question. So let us look at the next question, which is based on compensators and controllers. And the question is like this. Transfer function C of S is equal to 1 plus 0.2S upon 1 plus 0.05S. The compensator will have a maximum lead or lag at a frequency of dash radian per second. So you have to obtain the maximum phase lead or maximum phase lag. First of all, the key lies in just extracting information that this particular compensator is a lag compensator or a lead compensator, right? So you can extract it in two ways. See, if 1 plus 0.02, sorry, this is 1 plus 0.2s, right? So if this is in time constant form, just convert it into pole zero form. The pole are the transfer function C of S in pole zero form is some value, some constant k dash multiplied by 1 divided by 0.2. 1 divided by 0.2 is 5 plus s divided by 1. I'm just taking 0.2 common from this numerator and this 0.05 out of this multiple of s, right? So 1 divided by 0.05, it is 20 plus s. So you can clearly see the 0 is nearer to the j omega axis. Where is 0 located? 0 is located at minus 5 and pole is located at minus 20. 0 is located at minus 5 and pole is located at minus 20. So if at all, at any particular frequency, if we calculate the phase of this particular system, see the angle of elevation because of this 0 is more, phi z is more, and phi p is, it is clearly evident, right? So this phi z is looking at this particular frequency in this manner, whereas, see, angle of elevation is high, whereas this is looking at this particular frequency in a lower angle of elevation. This is phi p, right? Therefore, phase of the system is phase because of zeros, that is summation phi z minus summation phi p. Here there are only one zero and one pole, therefore I am writing it as phi z minus phi p. Phase is always leading. See, this is positive. Positive means what? Positive means leading, right? Therefore, this compensator is a lead compensator. Therefore, we have to find out the maximum phase lead and not maximum phase lag, right? So, frequency at which maximum phase lead occurs, that is what we need to find out. See, what they are trying to say is, if you obtain the pole zero plot of this particular transfer function, right? If you obtain the phase plot of this particular transfer function, phase of the transfer function, that is phi with respect to frequency, right? If at all you obtain the phase plot of this, the phase is going to start at zero, raise towards some maximum value, and again going to fall to zero, right? So at one particular instant, you can see the frequency at which maximum phase lead occurs, right? At one particular frequency, maximum phase lead occurs, and this is what is the frequency which you need to find out, right? So we generally have certain formulae for this. See, if these are your poles and zeros, this is your pole and this is your zero. Therefore, the first method which you can apply is omega max, frequency at which maximum phase lead occurs, is simply the geometric mean of both the critical frequencies. What are the critical frequency? One critical frequency is 0 and the other critical frequency is pole, that is 20. Therefore, geometric mean of under root 5 multiplied by 20. Therefore, omega max is equal to root 100. That is equal to 10 radian per second. Therefore, the answer is 10 radian per second. Right? This is one method. And the other method is, you can use the formula, you can compare this particular transfer function with the standard compensator network. Right? The standard transfer function of a lead compensator. The standard transfer function of a lead compensator is C lead of S. Let us say is equal to alpha into 1 plus ST upon 1 plus alpha TS. Alpha into 1 plus TS you can write. Alpha into 1 plus TS upon 1 plus alpha TS. This is a standard transfer function. Right. So, see, your controller transfer function, whichever is given to you, that need not be always the standard. Right. There might be some value of gain also. Some K value will also be there. Right. There is every possibility that this alpha is being multiplied by some K value. So, this is your transfer function. So, compare this with this. If you compare this with this, you can get the value of T. Value of T is directly evident, that is 0.2 seconds. Therefore, T is equal to 0.2 seconds and value of alpha T is 0.05. Alpha T is equal to 0.05. Therefore, alpha is equal to 0.05 divided by 0.2. 0.05 divided by 0.2. Alpha is equal to 0.25. You get the value of alpha as well. Now, just you have a formula for omega max, frequency at which maximum phase lead occurs. Omega max, you can say, is equal to 1 divided by T root alpha. That is equal to 1 divided by T. The value of T is how much? T is equal to 0.2. Root 0.25. It is 0.2 multiplied by 0.05. It is 100 divided by 2. Sorry, 100 divided by 5. That is simply is equal to 10 radian per second. If you can calculate like this also. This is one more approach. So let us say there are some students who cannot remember formulae. Right? So there is a possibility that they might forget this also. Geometric mean of the critical frequencies, they might forget this also, right? So there are possibilities. So for them, what is the approach they should use? Should they leave the question? No, they should never leave the question. The approach, it is the simple approach. See, how will you find out the maxima or minima of any particular thing? You will just differentiate it with respect to the parameter with respect to which you want to find out maxima, right? And equate it to zero, right? Simply, you have to obtain the maxima of phase and at what frequency the maxima happens, you will come to know, right? So, how will you obtain this? Let us look at this approach also. How can you write the phase as phase of this particular transfer function? Is simply, see, if you put S is equal to J omega, S is equal to J omega, you can write this particular transfer function as K dash into 5 plus J omega divided by 20 plus J omega. If at all you do not want to reduce it into this form, you can directly use this form, right? So this form is what? Phase of this you can find out like this, or else you can use the other form also. Phase of this is same as phase of 1 plus 0.2 times of J omega, 1 plus J 0.2 omega divided by 1 plus J 0.05 omega. The thing you have to do is you have to put S is equal to J omega, because see, S is Nepper's frequency. S has two things. S is equal to sigma plus J omega, right? So throughout frequency response analysis, what you're doing, see, this is phase plot. What you are doing, you are just applying various frequency inputs, various frequency sinusoids, right? Only oscillatory inputs you are providing, and you are not providing any exponentially decaying or exponentially growing signal. Therefore, sigma is zero, right? Within this Nepper's frequency, sigma is zero. You can simply put S is equal to J omega, right? That is what I've did. So if I put S is equal to J omega, I have to find out the phase of this particular transfer function, right? So the phase is nothing but simply phase of numerator minus phase of denominator. How can I find out the phase of numerator? It is simply tan inverse of 0.2 omega minus tan inverse of 0.05 omega, right? This is the phase. So let us differentiate phase with respect to omega. D phi by D omega is equal to simply 0.2 divided by 1 plus 0.2 square, that is 0.04 omega square, minus tan inverse of 0.05 divided by 1 plus 0.05 squared, that is simply 0.025 omega square. This value has to be is equal to 0. Yes or no? Because if you just equate it to 0, you will get the maxima or minima. For maxima or minima, you have to equate derivative of phase to 0, right? So let us just simplify this particular equation. So just you can clearly say they are cancelling by a factor of 4, right? This 0.05 multiplied by 4 is equal to 0.2. Therefore, this is 1, right? So just send this particular fraction that side and just cross multiply. And that is what I'm going to do here. So it is 4 into 1 plus. So it is 4 into 1 plus 0.0025 omega square, that is equal to 1 multiplied by 1 plus 0.04 omega square. 1 plus 0.04 omega square. So just multiply by 4. 4 plus 0.0025 multiplied by 4. See, all these calculations are pretty easy. They frame numericals like that only so that you can easily calculate. So 4 into 0.0025, this is simply 0.01 omega square, that is equal to 1 plus 0.04 omega square. So take this omega factor this side and this one this side. Therefore, you can write 0.04 minus 0.01. You can write it as 0.03 omega square, that is equal to 4 minus 1, that is equal to 3. Therefore, omega square is equal to how much? 3 divided by 0.03. This is simply is equal to 100. Therefore, omega is equal to under root 100, that is equal to 10 radians per second. Omega is equal to 10 radians per second. And the answer for this particular question is simply 10 radians per second. That is the answer. So let us look at the other questions also. So now let us look at the next question, which is also based on frequency response, right? So the question, you can say this particular question has repeated twice again. So this was a question from EC 2006 paper. This is a gate question from EC 2006 paper. See, what is the advantage? So if at all you practice all the previous gate questions, they are directly going to repeat, including the numericals, no change at all, completely repeated question, right? There is no change at all. So if at all you practice, there is a chance that you remember the answer and you can directly tick, right? So even if you do not remember the answer, this question is so easy, very, very easy, that you can answer it verbally without any calculation. So let us look at the question. To a system having transfer function 1 by s plus 1, sine t is applied as input. The output will be, right? So what you require is the output. Option A is 1 by 2 sine t. Option B, 1 by root 2 sine t minus pi by 4. Option C, 1 by root 2 cos t. And option D, 1 by 2 cos t minus pi by 4. So same as the previous question, even in this particular question, you are applying sinusoidal input to this particular system. Therefore, you can write S is equal to J omega. You can always put S is equal to j omega whenever you provide sinusoidal input, whether it is sin t, cos t, whatever is it, right? If it is a sinusoidal input, you can put like this, right? So now let us look at omega value. You just compare this input with sin omega t. Sin omega t, what is omega? Omega is simply 1. Omega is 1. Therefore, S is equal to how much? S is equal to j directly. Therefore, what happened to the transfer function now? You can write the transfer function as 1 by 1 plus j. Right? This is simply a complex number. A complex number divided by another complex number. 1 divided by 1 plus j. So you can write this complex number as 1 by root 2. Its magnitude is 1 by root 2, right? How will you find out its magnitude? 1 divided by under root 1 square plus 1 square. And what is the phase of this? Phase of 1 plus j is 45 degrees, tan inverse of 1 by 1. And phase of 1 by 1 plus j is minus 45 degrees. Minus 45 degrees. So you can write it as 1 by root 2 at an angle minus 45 or minus pi by 4. You can write it like this. Because our question has minus pi by 4 and all, they are given radians. I'm writing it in radians. Right? This is the transfer function. And to this particular transfer function, you have applied an input sine omega t. Right? Which means you can take your input as a reference. You can write sine omega t in polar form. If at all you write it in polar form, you can write it as 1 at an angle 0 degrees. Which, since you are taking it as reference. Right? So with the reference to the input, the output is asked. So this is your transfer function. Transfer function is 1 divided by root 2 at an angle minus pi by 4. And to this, what is applied? 1 at an angle 0 is applied. Therefore, the output is going to be 1 at an angle 0 multiplied by 1 by root 2 at an angle minus pi by 4. It is simply 1 by root 2 at an angle minus pi by 4. So how can you write it? Because you have taken sine t as reference, you can write this as 1 by root 2 sine t minus pi by 4. You can simply write it like this, 1 by root 2 sine t minus pi by 4. Therefore, tell me which is the correct answer for this question. Option B is the correct answer for this particular question. So you can answer it verbally if you look at these options. Just by looking at the transfer function and this, you got to know that this transfer function is simply 1 by 1 plus j. So it is 1 by root 2 at an angle minus 45. 1 by root 2 at an angle minus 45 multiplied by 1 at an angle 0. It is 1 by root 2 at an angle minus 45. Simply, you can directly tick that b is equal to 1 by root 2 sine t minus pi by 4 is the answer. And let us look at the next question now. So let us look at this question, which is based on the steady state stability limits, or else you can say the relative stability parameters, that are gain margin and phase margin of frequency response. So the question is like this: the open loop transfer function of your closed loop system is given, that is UFS HFS is equal to 2 into S plus 1 by S square, so which is given here. The system has a phase margin of dash degrees, right? You have to find out the phase margin of this particular system. So first of all, before finding out phase margin and gain margin, you should know the formulae, or else indirectly you can say the expression how to obtain gain margin or phase margin, right? So phase margin is equal to comparison of the phase lag of your particular system, comparison of phase lag of your particular system at gain crossover frequency with respect to 180 degrees. 180 degrees plus the phase of your system, that is g of s, h of s, at omega is equal to omega gc. What is omega gc? Frequency at which gain crossover occurs. Frequency at which gain crossover occurs means, gain crossover means simply gain of the system, that is magnitude of g of s, h of s. Magnitude of g of s, h of s is equal to 1. The frequency at which magnitude of g of s, h of s is equal to 1 is called as gain crossover frequency, right? So it is the comparison of phase lag of your system before phase reversal, because after phase reversal, what happens is there is a chance that your system might become unstable, right? So this theory informs you about stability, relative stability. It will also give you something regarding relative stability,
So before phase reversal, if you compare the phase lag of this particular system with respect to phase, with respect to 180 degrees, that is phase margin, right? So after the phase shift occurs by 180 degrees, let us say this is your particular system, right? This is OLTF, and in this particular system, the frequency at which phase reversal occurs, there is a high chance that system might go into instability if gain is not proper, right? So this is the expression for phase margin. And gain margin, as it is very important for you people, for EC and electrical students whose gate paper is still needed to be given. For EC tomorrow you have gate paper, as well as for electrical you have on 8th, right? So I just want to remind you, gain margin. What is gain margin? Gain margin is simply 20 log magnitude 1 by 20 log modulus of 1 by magnitude of G of S, H of S. That is 20 log inverse of OLTF gain at omega is equal to omega PC. What is omega PC? Frequency at which phase crossover occurs, right? So frequency at which the phase plot of your transfer function crosses minus 180 degrees line, right? Omega PC is that frequency at which phase of G of S, H of S is equal to minus 180 degrees. So we are only asked to find out the value of phase margin. So we'll find out phase margin only. So what is your OLTF? OLTF is G of S, H of S is equal to 2 into S plus 1 by S square. So first of all, you have to find out the gain crossover frequency omega GC. In order to find out the gain crossover frequency, you have to find out the magnitude of this, right? Magnitude of G of S, H of S. Magnitude of G of S, H of S. And you have to equate it to 1, right? So you just equate this magnitude to 1. So for finding out the magnitude, what you should do is you have to put S is equal to what? S is equal to J omega. If at all you put S is equal to J omega, right, what happens to the transfer function? Transfer function is like this. 2 into J omega plus 1 divided by J omega whole square. And the magnitude of this you need to find out, right? So I'm finding out the magnitude. That is equal to 2 under root 1 square plus omega square divided by omega square. This, if you equate it to 1, you will get an algebraic equation in terms of omega, and you have to solve that particular value of that particular equation to get the value of omega, right? So it is simply, you can say, 4 into 1 plus omega square. I'm cross multiplying on both sides and squaring. Cross multiply and square. This value is equal to omega power 4. Therefore, this equation becomes omega power 4 minus 4 omega square minus 4 is equal to 0. Right? So to find out omega, first you have to find out omega square. Omega square is equal to plus 4 plus or minus root over d square minus 4ac by 2a. Right? So for omega square, you are going to get two values. That is minus 0.828, and the other value is 4.828. So square of a frequency, it cannot be negative, right? So omega cannot be complex. S can be j omega, S can be complex, but omega cannot be complex, right? So square of this is a negative number. Therefore, you can term this particular value as invalid value. This is what? This is invalid. So the value you will consider for omega square is 4.828. Therefore, this is a valid value. So considering the valid value, omega is equal to under root 4.828. So its value, let us look at its value. Its value is 2.197 radian per second. 2.197 radians per second. This is the value of omega, right? So phase margin is 180 degrees plus phase of the system, right? Phase of the system at omega GC. You got omega GC and you have to find out phase margin. Therefore, phase margin is equal to 180 degrees plus phase of this particular transfer function. So phase of the numerator 2, its phase is 0, and j omega plus 1, its phase is what? Its phase is tan inverse of omega by 1 minus j omega square, that is minus 90 degrees into 2. Therefore, this is plus 180, this is minus 180, both get cancelled. It is simply tan inverse of omega. Therefore, phase margin is equal to tan inverse of omega. What is the value of omega you got? Tan inverse of 2.197. So if at all you convert it into degrees, tan inverse of 2.197, the value you are getting is 65.526. 65.526. Degrees, 65.526. So calculation wise, it is okay, right? You're getting some phase margin, which means your system is stable for some sort of frequencies, right? So let us look at some more detailed analysis of this particular question, right? So this is in fact a very good question. So by taking similar question, student can be put into a lot of confusion, because student will generalize some particular concepts. Right. So, because by taking this particular system, by considering this particular system, we can simply give a counter statement to all those statements which students directly, students blindly mug up, right? Students blindly generalize. So, we'll look into it. But before looking into it, let me emphasize you on one point. A similar question is given in EE 2005, right? In EE 2005, a similar question is given. In that particular question, this 2 is not present and the value of gain margin is asked. Here phase margin is asked and there gain margin is asked. And when that question came, that came in EE 2005. So whenever you find time, just try to play with the previous gate questions. Just play with the previous gate questions. You'll end up with amazing results, and also there are chances that you may get repeated questions. Right? This is not exactly repeated, but still you would have an idea if you have solved this particular question in EE 2005. So let us look at the other approach, right? Which students generally do wrong. So the same question can be done in other way also, but there will be a slight error. I'll explain you how. So if at all you have solved previous gate questions, you remember that there is a question in which there is a clue given, right? So they have asked you to find out this particular phase margin using the asymptotic Bode plot, right? So g of s is given to be 10 divided by s plus 0.1 into s plus 1 into s plus 10. So this was the transfer function, and this is a question given in EC 2014, right? In previous gate EC 2014, this was the question given. So what is asked there is, they have asked you to calculate the value of phase margin by just calculating the value, by just obtaining the value of gain crossover frequency omega gc from asymptotic Bode plot. Right. So until and unless mentioning the question, see in this question, why did they mention that you have to calculate omega gc from the asymptotic Bode plot? Is they are indirectly giving a clue so that you can solve it quickly, so that you can get the value of omega gc as quick as possible, right? Because if at all you want to find out omega gc numerically by numerical calculations, it is a sixth degree equation in terms of omega, right? So that is difficult for you. So in order to avoid that difficulty, they have given you a clue to find out the value using asymptotic Bode plot. Whereas in cases like this, right? If at all you find using asymptotic Bode plot, there is a chance that you might commit a slight mistake, right? The mistake will be, of course, within some 2 to 3 degrees only, but still that may put you out of the range, right? So let us look at the approach also. So first of all, let us construct the Bode plot for this, asymptotic Bode plot for this, right? So magnitude in decibels versus frequency, this is what is the plot that you need to get. Magnitude versus frequency, right? So magnitude at low frequencies is clearly evident, that is zero. If you put S is equal to zero, low frequencies means S is approximately zero. The gain is infinite, right? So this will start at infinite, and from there it is going with a slope. It is coming down with a slope of minus 40 decibel per decade, right? Minus 40 decibel per decade is its slope of declination. The reason is there are two poles at origin. So this is the plot. You can look at the plot like this. This is how it is coming from low frequencies. But at omega is equal to 1 radian per second, what is the magic that happened? There is a zero. Because of this zero, its slope has now decreased, right? So slope decreased, in the sense I can say the steepness has decreased and the slope is minus 20 decibels per decade now. Initially the slope was minus 40 decibels per decade, right? At omega is equal to 1, you have zero at critical frequency. And the frequency at which gain crossover occurs, omega GC, this is what you need to find out, right? So if at all you go by Bode plot, what is the approach you should use? We'll see. So first of all, you have to find out the magnitude of this particular transfer function at any particular frequency, right? So let us choose one, because one seems to be easy, right? So magnitude in decibels at omega is equal to 1, this is what we need to find out, right? So put omega is equal to 1 in this. If omega is equal to 1, g of j omega, h of j omega will be is equal to 2 into 1 plus j divided by j omega. The magnitude of j omega, h of j omega is simply modulus of this, that is equal to 2 root 2 divided by the value of j omega squared. The value of j omega, the magnitude of j omega when omega is 1 is this. Therefore, the magnitude of the transfer function when omega is equal to 1, at omega is equal to 1, the magnitude is how much? It is 2 root. So find out the magnitude in decibels. Magnitude in decibels when omega is equal to 1 is how much? This is 20 log 2 root. 20 log 2 root 2, you can write it as 20 log 2 plus 20 log root 2, right? 20 log 2 plus 20 log root 2, I remember the values because these are the values which we often use, right? So speaking more accurately, it is 6.02 decibels plus 3.01 decibels, right? But the magnitude which you got in decibels, that is 9.03 decibels, that is what? That is the actual magnitude. That is not the asymptotic magnitude. See, if you get the asymptotic magnitude, it will be easier for you to obtain a straight line equation and to put this particular value in that particular straight line equation, and you can easily calculate the value. So if at all you look at the exact plot, is somewhat like this. It will have an error of 3 decibels at the corner frequency. See, both of them will not coincide at the corner frequency. At the corner frequency, it will be 3 decibels more than this asymptotic plot. Actual plot will be 3 decibels more than asymptotic plot, because you have a 0 at omega is equal to 1. 0 means the actual value is 3 decibels more. If it is a pole, the actual value is 3 decibels less, right? So accurately speaking, this is 3.01 decibels. This particular error is 3.01 decibels. So before going into that, before calculating this straight line equation, what is the magnitude you have to take at omega is equal to 1? That is your confusion, right? So you have to consider omega is equal to, at omega is equal to 1, the magnitude is 6.02 decibels. Why 6.02 decibels? The asymptotic plot is 3.01 decibels less than the actual value. Actual value is 6.002 decibels plus 3.01 decibels. So this 3.01 decibels less is what you need to consider in order to make calculations using this straight line equation. So we'll look at very simple approach. So just look at it. See, you can easily write down this straight line equation as, the smartest way to write the straight line equation is 20 log k by s, because the slope is minus 20 decibels per decade. This is 20 log k by s, right? If the slope is minus 40 dB per decade, then this, then 20 log k by s square, right? Modulus of k by s square at omega is equal to 1. S is equal to j omega. Anyways, its magnitude is going to be omega only, right? At omega is equal to 1, is equal to how much? 6.02 decibels, right? So if you put 6.02 decibels, what you'll get is, see, you have to find out the value of k from this. Therefore, k will be is equal to, simply I am putting omega is equal to 1, or else I can write k by omega. At omega is equal to 1, is equal to 10 power 6.02 divided by 20. Right? Therefore, k value, k is equal to simply 10 power 6.02 divided by 20. This is the value, k is equal to 10 power 6.02 divided by 20. And from this, you have to find out this gain crossover frequency. How can you find out the gain crossover frequency? Once you got the equation of this particular straight line, see, I'm just talking about this segment of the straight line, this particular segment of the straight line, right? The equation of this particular segment of straight line, that is this particular straight line, is 20 log k by s. Right, you got the value of k. Now, using the value of k, you can find out the value of gain crossover frequency omega gc. So the value of k can be calculated like this. K is equal to 10 power 6.02 divided by 20, that is 0.301, right? So if at all you find it using your calculator, you will get it as 1.9998 something, right? Therefore, k you can consider it as approximately is equal to 2, right? K is approximately is equal to 2. So for what frequency now this particular transfer function crosses this 0 decibel line? That is what you need to find out, because gain of g of s h of s is 0. Sorry, gain of g of s h of s is equal to 1 means its decibel value is 0 decibels. So at what frequency this crosses the 0 dB line is what you need to see. Right. So for that, what you will do, you will equate this 20 log k by omega is equal to 0. Right. So 10 power 0, see, this 0 divided by 20 is anyways 0. Therefore, k is equal to 10 power 0. Right. So k is equal to k by omega is equal to 10 power 0. That implies omega is equal to, omega is nothing but omega gc here, right? Gain crossover frequency, this frequency we are finding out, right? The value of omega at which the magnitude is 0. Therefore, omega gc is simply is equal to k. K is how much? 2. Therefore, omega gc is equal to 2 radian per second, right? So in that, in the direct using numerical calculations, what is the value of omega you got? You got some 2.179, I think. 2.197 or 1179, something like this, you got the value, right? The value you got here is approximately 2 radian per second. See, to let you know about the procedure, how to calculate it in the smartest way, because we have still exams of electrical as well as instrumentation, sorry, electrical as well as EC pending, right? So to make you know how to calculate, using the smartest approach, I have shown you this method, and there is one more smartest method using which you can get the value of omega GC directly. See, if the value here is 6.02 decibels, the slope is minus 20 dB per decade, right? What is the slope in octaves? In octave scale, it is minus 6.02 decibels per octave, right? From 1 to 2 radian per second, it is 1 octave. Therefore, within 1 octave, it will become 0. See, from omega is equal to 1 radian per second, it is falling down to 0, which means this gap is equal to how much? 1 octave. From 1 to 2, it is 1 octave. Omega is equal to 2 radian per second. So, right, from 1 to 2 radian per second, it is 1 octave. So, you can clearly say that this is 2 radian per second from the graph itself. Right. So, once you got the value of omega GC is equal to 2 radian per second, you have to put this particular value in phase margin. The formula for phase margin is 180 plus phase of your system. Right. That is simply tan inverse of omega. That is tan inverse of 2, which just compare with the previous solution also. Right. So, I am going a little fast. Therefore, it is tan inverse of 2. The value of tan inverse of 2 is how much? 63.43 degrees. 63.43 degrees. Therefore, the disadvantage here, if you go by this particular method, right, that is the asymptotic Bode plot method, right, if at all you go by this method, the disadvantage here is there is 2 degrees of difference, right, there is 2 degrees of difference, which is a comparable value, which is a considerable value, right. So, never apply those methods until and unless they were specified in the question, because you already know asymptotic Bode plot is an approximation. This is already an approximation, right? So we have to draw several other conclusions also, right? See, this is one thing, okay, right? Previously you got the answer as 65.526. The phase margin you got as 65.526. Let us wait and see what is the answer that will be given by the gate board. Gate board will definitely give this answer only, 65.526. But there are several other conclusions that can be drawn from this particular question. This is such an excellent question, right? So if at all you have played with this similar question which had come in previous gate, that is 2005 electrical, right? You would come to know this is very excellent question. So you have phase margin, okay? If at all you calculate gain margin, you are going to get gain margin as infinite. See, I'll just find out the gain margin in 1 second from this graph directly. So look at the phase plot also. Let us consider the phase plot also for this. This is frequency scale and this is 0 degree line. And the phase initially, when frequency is 0, the phase is minus 180 degrees. Phase is minus 180 degrees. Put low values of omega. For low values of omega in this, see, I'm writing g of s, h of s, OLTF like this, 2 j omega plus 1 divided by j omega square. For low values of omega, this omega is negligible in front of 1, so it is 2 divided by j omega square. The phase started at minus 180 degrees, right? You have a 0 at 1, which means from a decade prior to 1, that is 0.1, to a decade after 1, that is 10, the phase starts to vary, right? So here the phase starts to increase and it will increase till 10, right? It will increase till this particular value, and from here the phase is going to be again constant. So at this particular value, the phase is some minus 90 degrees. So if you look at the phase plot, where is the phase crossover happening, right? What is the frequency at which the phase of your open loop transfer function is minus 180 degrees? This is the frequency, that is low frequency, DC frequency. At low frequency or DC frequency, you can say what is the magnitude of this particular transfer function. Magnitude is infinite, which means gain margin is decibel value of inverse of magnitude, right? Gain margin is what? Gain margin is decibel value of inverse of magnitude, right? Inverse of g of s, h of s,
and magnitude is magnitude in decibels, right? This is what? This is gain margin. So magnitude is infinity, and inverse of this means you will get minus 20 log modulus of g of s h of s, right? So gain margin is minus infinity. For this particular system, you're going to get a gain margin of minus infinity, which says that your system is unstable. If gain margin is negative, system is unstable. See, for this system, you're getting gain margin as minus infinity, but what is happening? You're getting the phase margin as positive, right? So what will you conclude? The system is stable or unstable, right? And you know one more theory. If gain crossover frequency is greater than phase crossover frequency, students blindly mug up this point. If gain crossover frequency is greater than phase crossover frequency, phase crossover frequency is almost at zero, right? Gain crossover frequency is at 2 radian per second, right? If omega GC is greater than omega PC, or else if omega PC is less than omega GC, they say the system is unstable. They say that the system is unstable. But if you look at the root locus of this particular system, I'll just show you the root locus within a short diagram here. So if at all you look at the root locus will be somewhat like this. There are two poles at the origin, and there is 1, 0 at minus 1, right? So it is going to be a locus like this. It is going to form a circle in this manner, right? One pole goes to infinity in this manner, and the other pole approaches this 0, right? This is the root locus. From k is equal to 0 to k approaching infinity, right? This is the root locus. The closed loop system is stable for all values of k, right? So the system is stable. The closed loop system is stable. Whereas from relative stability parameters, what are you going to say? The system might be unstable. This is what you are going to conclude. So this is such a special question. Options can be framed like this, right? See, as students just blindly mug up that particular point, options, if I frame options like this, let us say the first option is omega GC is less than omega PC and the system is stable. Option B, omega PC is less than omega GC and the system is unstable. Option C and option D, I can frame somewhat like that, right? What students will do is, students will blindly calculate omega PC and omega GC. They'll get the value of omega PC as zero radian per second. Omega PC is zero radian per second. If you calculate, you'll get it. Omega GC, you'll get it as 2.197 if you calculate, right? So in this case, omega GC is greater than omega PC, and students know when omega GC is greater than omega PC, they concluded the system is unstable, right? So what they will generally do is, they'll blindly take this option, which is wrong, right? The closed loop system is always stable, right? The third option can be like this. Omega PC is less than omega GC, but the system is stable. This is going to be the correct answer for this question, right? Of course, we have seen the gate question, right? So, but this session, this ending part is especially for the upcoming students having exam in the upcoming dates, right? Electrical and EC students. So, if at all such a question comes in your exam, don't just blindly go by this particular conclusion, right? This is valid only for some cases, right? One is, this is valid only for minimum phase systems. This is not valid for non-minimum phase systems. And there are certain exceptions, right? So never ever blindly just go by this, right? So the conclusion is, the answer you can calculate asymptotically as well as just from numerical calculations. But in this question, it is not at all mentioned to calculate asymptotically. There is no way of simplifying. The asymptotic Bode plot is complicating a little, complicating the calculations comparatively. So you have to calculate and calculate the value, find out the value of omega, and you will get the value of omega GC as 2.197. Right? If at all you go by asymptotic Bode plot, you'll get it as 2 radian per second, which has a slight error. Right? If you calculate phase margin, you'll get 2 degrees of error. Right? Which is considerable error in gate examination. Right? So finally, the answer is this. So with this, we are concluding all the instrumentation gate questions that we got, memory based questions which we got, are completed. Right? So hope you liked the video. Just share with your friends and always feel free to comment if you have any doubts. Just use the comment box. Thank you.